rotator cuff disease, when to wait and when to repair. Rotator cuff provides a dynamic stabilization of glenohumeral joint and contributes to shoulder movement. And the important thing is that it's a functional anatomic unit and not for unrelated tendons. And if we have an injury to one component, it has an influence to all others. Rotator cuff disease represents a progressive continuum of pathology, ranging from subacromial impingement and tendinosis to full thickness tears, and if left untreated, to cuff tear arthropathy. The key word here is progressive, because once the tendon starts to tear, there's very little we can do to hold or to reverse that pathology. So rotator cuff tears lower the functional reserves of the shoulder, and when the demands exceeds the reserves, we have clinical symptoms. The philosophy of our treatment, all we want is a good clinical result, and all we want is to restore the equilibrium between the demands and the capacity of the cuff. So how we can restore the equilibrium? We can wait, lower the functional demands of the patient, or we can increase the functional capacity of the remaining intact cuff, physio. Or to repair or augment the cuff with grafts, tendon transfers, or reverse shoulder arthroplasty. Let's see some facts about the rotator cuff. Yamaguchi had studied a large number of patients presenting with unilateral shoulder pain and revealing an age-dependent incidence of disease. Both shoulders examined by ultrasound, and there was an almost perfect decay difference of tear patterns. The average age was 48 years for patients with no rotator cuff tear, 58 years for patients with unilateral tear, and 67 years for bilateral tears. And after the age of 66 years, there was a 50% likelihood of bilateral tears. Another paper by Kim. Kim examined the patterns of cuff tears and muscle changes, and fatty muscle changes were seen almost exclusive in all full thickness tears. Whereas in partial thickness tears, the muscle belly is shown normal. And in the shoulders with supraspinatus atrophy, the most predictive tear characteristic was the involvement of the most anterior edge of the supraspinatus tendon, where the cambly insertion. When we have infraspinatus atrophy, the important thing was the size of the tear. Trying to understand the natural history of these tears, we're identifying some risk factors for the onset of the symptoms. Malleol looked at 195 shoulders with painless tears, and approximately 20% of these tears became painful within 2 years follow-up. The onset of the symptoms was associated with two factors. One was tear size progression, when seen about 23% of newly painful shoulders versus only 5% in painless shoulders. What if we inject steroids while waiting? Here's a systematic review on arthroscopy 2019 about the adverse impact of the corticosteroid injections on rotator cuff health and repair. And the results, when we have a single corticosteroid injection, associated with increased risk of revision of rotator cuff repair when administered up to a year before surgery. And we have almost double postoperative infections up to 1 month before surgery. And there was a greater risk for adverse outcomes if the injection administered within 6 months of surgery, and if we have more than two injections given within a year of surgery. So, what about partial thickness rotator cuff tears? We can treat them conservatively. Here is a very nice paper on Journal of Shoulder and Elbow Surgery, 2020, about the predictors of failure after conservative treatment of partial tears, partial thickness rotator cuff tears. 272 patients with symptomatic partial thickness tears, and we have a conservative treatment for 6 months. All the subjective assessments was with ASSESS and VAS, constant score, and also as a failure considered the pain or not return to activities after 6 months. So the results, symptoms subsided completely or considerably in 63%, from which the disease relapsed in 12%, and symptoms led to surgery in 36%. The failure rate was higher in the dominant hand injuries, the bursal side, and the tears involving more than 50% of tendon depth. And if we have a partial thickness tear, bursal type, in the dominant hand, involving more than 50% of the tendon depth, the worst case scenario, then should we go for repair immediately? Another paper from Kim, American Journal of Sports Medicine, 2018, about when we should repair a partial thickness rotator cuff tear. So two group of patients, the group one immediate repair, group two delayed repair after 6 months, and mean follow-up 32 and 37 months respectively. The results, both groups, immediate and delayed repair were effective, very low re-tear rate, and 2 and 6 months postoperative, lower VAS and higher ASSESS score for delayed group. So in conclusion, a trial period of preoperative conservative repair is reasonable, and immediate repair for partial thickness is not crucial. The treatment of painful cuff tears should be individualized, and we must answer the question whether the goal of the treatment is simply to convert a painful tear to a painless tear, or to offer a patient a long-term solution, identify tears with a good healing potential, and indicating these patients for early surgery. There are many studies that show good clinical short-term results with conservative management and over 80% success. However, there is a little evidence that conservative treatment is beneficial in the long run. Studies note declined function and progressive atrophy. In addition, there is no data supporting healing in full thickness rotator cuff tears over time with conservative treatment. So many studies correlated the outcome of cuff repair surgery with cuff healing, although it's a little bit debatable. The most two reliable and consistent factors affecting the healing was two: the patient age and the size of the tear. The potential of the healing seems to diminish with the multiple tendon tears, and the ability to heal seems to decline after the age of 65 years. So, which are our indications for early repair in a degenerative full thickness rotator cuff tears? Tears involving the anterior supraspinatus tendon, tears with early degenerative muscle changes, age less than 55, and acute and chronic tears with recent loss of function or tear enlargement. And of course, tears that fails conservative treatment. So, in conclusion, we can wait If we have a patient with a newly diagnosed symptomatic impingement, patient with a newly diagnosed partial thickness rotator cuff tear, asymptomatic tears, stable tears with minimal muscle changes, and chronic tears with advanced degenerative muscle changes. If we have older patients, more than 70 years, or medical comorbidities. But while we're waiting, it's recommended that because the size of the tears appears to be an important factor in the development of symptoms, we recommended surveillance at yearly intervals for patients with known tears and treated non-operatively. And caution when decide to inject corticosteroids and should be withheld if a rotator cuff repair is to be performed within the following 6 months. And potential risk if we wait so long, tear enlargement, size and retraction, muscle degenerative changes, larger tears and tears involve the anterior cable, advancing age of the patient, and glenohumeral arthritic changes and cuff tear arthropathy. So, thank you for your attention.